Here now to discuss Capri Cafaro, former Ohio State Senate Minority Leader, Ned Ryan, American Majority CEO, also former George W. Bush presidential writer, and John Hanna, former National Security Advisor to Vice President Cheney. John, let me start with you. Very powerful speech about what everyone expected, although I wasn't prepared necessarily for the hit on OPEC. Nevertheless, President Trump not intimidated, not afraid to speak his mind and really go after the establishment, the UN establishment, and the way globalism has changed the world.
Yeah, no, this was, whether you agree with it or disagree with it, Charles, this was really Trump unleashed. If you're a world leader, you want to know, what does the American president think? Where does he see the main threats and problems in the world, and how is he going to go forward to try and resolve those? And I think you got what the preoccupations of President Trump are. It's a defense of American sovereignty. He's opposed to the globalist ideology. He thinks we're getting ripped off on trade, on foreign aid, on OPEC, and he sees major threats in Iran, North Korea, Venezuela. So you got a good understanding of what the Trump doctrine is if you listen to that speech today, and that's all you can ask for as a foreign leader.
You know, Ned, a minute after the speech, the Washington Post put out an article saying that President Trump declared his administration will reject attempts from other nations to impose constraints. And it said that he would use his judgment over how it would benefit Americans. In other words, somehow, according to the Washington Post, by rejecting the consensus of our allies and even partners, that would somehow be in the worst interest of Americans. We have to listen to the rest of the world to dictate our policies here.
What an absurd philosophy in response to his speech. I mean, he went in there, Charles, into the heart of globalism. And I think two sentences really encapsulate what Donald Trump is about. He went in and said, we reject the ideology of globalism and we embrace the doctrine of patriotism, and we will never surrender American sovereignty to an unelected, unaccountable global bureaucracy. America is governed and ruled by Americans. That, to me, encapsulates everything that Donald Trump is about, why he was elected. And it, you know, if I was to call it anything, Charles, I would call it Americanism. But more importantly, it's just really common sensism. When right. He stands up there and says, we're not going to protect you, OPEC, if you're going to go gouge us on prices. We're not going to give foreign aid to people that hate us and are not our friends. We're not going to sit here and let China take all of our manufacturing jobs and 60,000 of our factories. And oh, by the way, we're going to squeeze Iran economically and not let them have nuclear capabilities that will become an existential threat. It's common sense.
Capri, of course, many on the left saw those same comments that Ned is embracing as a dog whistle to nationalism, as a dog whistle to isolationism, as a dog whistle to America rejecting its role as the global leader. Do you agree?
No, I hate the term dog whistle, because somehow it you know, evokes this nefarious, it really means something that is racist or, you know, underhanded or something of that nature. I mean, there's no dog whistles here, and there's no surprises in what President Trump said. You know, he has always said that he is, subscribes to this America First view. And, you know, as such, organizations like the United Nations, I think in the view of President Trump and others in his administration, see that as, you know, somehow subversive to the autonomy and the sovereignty of the United States. That is an ideological difference that has existed in sort of the, the far right aspects of the Republican foreign policy over the years. So none of this is shocking to me, but... Oh, go ahead.
Would you say, though, that the UN has been an effective organization for all of the money and resources that we've contributed to it? Would you say that it has been a real true ally to America and our interests over the years?
Look, we are one of the founders of the United Nations. I think one of the biggest challenges of the UN and any multinational organization, including things like NATO, is they were created in the wake of the end of the Second World War. And the world looks incredibly different than it did in 1945, when a number of these organizations were founded. Interestingly, I was at an event today that American University hosted where Senator Bob Corker spoke, and he actually talked a little bit about the United Nations and said, we complain about it because it's not necessarily the most effective, but it is a convening organization. And if it didn't exist, we might want to create something that would fill that void. And I think that's the issue. You don't want to throw the baby out with the bathwater. And
right.
We also have to recognize that, yes, we want to stand up for sovereignty and for, you know, our domestic interests. But part of that is finding a way to engage in the global community, making sure that we retain that trust with our other allies that share our common values and not alienate them because we seem that, you know, we want to retreat from the global conversation.
Well,
we have to find that balance.
John, you know, it's interesting that Capri would say that because, you know, the UN, again, after the World War II, you had a whole lot of things, you know, the rebuilding, the amount of money that America poured into Europe to rebuild it, the Marshall Plan. Things have certainly changed. Today, our quote-unquote allies, we discovered yesterday that they all got together, the EU, Asia, and some other countries, all allies, figuring out a way to circumvent our tariffs, or rather, us moving away from the Iranian deal. They still want to do business with Iran. And they're saying, hey, we don't care that they're spreading terrorism in the region, that they're fostering discontent, that they're wrecking nations, that they sponsor, you know, the deaths of innocent children. They don't care. As long as they can make a buck off of Iran, this long-term relationship and the trillions of dollars we poured into it doesn't matter.
Yeah, no, this is it's a serious disagreement. The U.S. decision to unilaterally get out of that deal. Europe clearly has a much different view. I'm not sure it's exactly the view you say, Charles. I think they do have deep concerns about Iranian terrorism and aggression throughout the region, but they also think that this deal somehow puts a cap on the Iranian nuclear program and sets that aside for a decade or so. I think they're wrong. The Trump administration clearly thinks they're wrong. And now we're going to have a showdown because despite whatever circumvention mechanisms they're going to try to put in place to keep their companies doing business there, at the end of the day, the overwhelming power still of the U.S. economy and the U.S. financial system and dollar are going to leave European companies voting on the basis of their bottom lines.
Real quick, Ned, the idea that America is somehow embracing isolationism because we're rejecting globalism.
No, that's not true at all. Americanism is not about isolationism. It's about saying we're going, an American president saying, I'm going to put the priorities of the American taxpayer first. We have friends, we have allies. The thing that's frustrating me a little bit, Charles, about all of this with the EU and Mexico and Canada and all these other allies, we're not living in a post-World War II era. It's the 21st century. We helped rebuild your nations. We helped rebuild your economies. It doesn't mean that we have to take the short end of the stick any longer. And right now, Trump realizes our economy's roaring. Now's the time to negotiate for better deals. We're still going to have friends. They're still going to have great trade deals. But it's time to actually put the American people first and get their priorities first,
all right,
instead of giving away all these things on the global stage.
Yeah, thank you all very, very much.